had no idea that this woman would become Janet Jackson.
She had a very domineering and dictatorial father.
I felt I can't be the only young adult in this world that is experiencing these feelings.
She was just like, enough. I'm going to be who I am, and I'm going to speak loudly for myself.
You ever want to know anything about Janet? Just listen to her albums. Listen to the lyrics.
I was writing what was going on in my life. That's the way I've always written. That's the only way I know how to write.
Janet was someone the music industry at large knew they were going to have to respect.
With each subsequent record, you know, she gets more and more provocative to the point where you're like, Janet, like, you know, man.
Michael needed Janet much more at the moment that he does Scream than Janet ever needed Michael. We have so few examples of pop stars who can continue to build a career and be able to do it consistently on their own terms.
This is a story about control. My control.
Fighting for her share of the limelight was never going to be easy for Janet Demeter Jo Jackson, the little sister of the musical phenomenon that was the Jackson family. Janet was born in the Rust Belt industrial town of Gary, Indiana, near Chicago, on May 16, 1966, the youngest of nine children, all raised as Jehovah's Witnesses. Their father, Joseph, a crane operator at the local steel mill, had big plans for his children.
Jacksons go from being this small, family-knit group from Gary to all of a sudden becoming this huge nationwide phenomenon.
By the time Janet was five, her brothers had signed to Motown, had four number ones on the American Billboard 100, were touring extensively, and even had their own TV series.
When she first saw us in a cartoon, she was like so happy for us to see that, you know. And she watched it every Saturday morning. You know, she would get up early in the morning, eating her cereal, watching the Jackson 5 cartoon. Janet was like a tomboy. She was always running around, playing football, climbing trees, and she was something else.
Following their early success, Father Joe moved the whole family from the Midwest to California. He wanted the brothers to be right at the heart of the entertainment industry.
When I used to go out to interview the Jacksons, we didn't really want to be bothered with Janet. We'd see her around playing or something like that, and we had no idea that this woman would become Janet Jackson.
But in the Jackson household, even playtime was showtime.
My brother Mike and I, he was Fred Astaire, I was Ginger Rogers, and we'd learn every routine. Our mirror was our... The reflection off the window, we had this huge sliding door off the pool, leading to the pool from the house. And we used to use that as our mirror, and we'd be outside learning routines all day long.
You sing with the group?
In the Jackson 5 family, everybody works.
Not surprisingly, Janet was soon roped into the family business. By the age of 10, she was appearing with her brother Randy on the Jacksons' very own variety show.
It's not easy to be the only female person in that very male space, and also to be the youngest of such a famous group. Very early on, we saw that she had a very clear idea about doing something different for herself.
Yes, the beat goes on.
I was doing the Jacksons' television summer specials, and it just so happens that Norman Lear, who did Sanford and Son, All in the Family, Jeffersons, I mean, so many good times, so many different shows, Maude, happened to see me, and they needed to cast a young girl.
Janet was auditioned for the role of Little Penny in U.S. sitcom Good Times.
They called me in for an interview, and We did this improv, and he loved the way that it went. It got very emotional. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just going with what I felt, I guess, in my gut. And as I was walking out of the building, he said, if you want to have the part, you can. It's yours. So that's how I was just 10 years old.
She's pretty much grown up as pop royalty from the day she was born. And so I think people don't always understand how much credit she has to be given for her real acting chops at a very young age.
Now the world don't move to the beat of just one drum.
Her success as Penny led to a part in the even more popular series Different Strokes, which told the story of two adopted African-American Harlem kids, Arnold and Willis.
They got nothing but the jeans.
It became a big success with black people and white people because the concept was universal, because it really was just about love.
I want to meet my sister Kimberly and my little brother.
Playing Charlene, Willis's girlfriend, Janet was a big hit with audience and cast alike.
No wonder he's willing to risk the best years of his life.
From what I'm hearing, Todd had a crush on me, and that's how I got the job.
When I got her on the show, the plan was, you know, for me to start dating her. That was my plan.
He wanted me to be his girlfriend in the show, so I was his girlfriend in the show.
Well, we were definitely had a natural attraction towards one another. Do the hustle.
I was shocked to see my little sister growing up so fast. She did like a little love thing where she was had a little kissing role on there. It was hard for me to see that.
Janet, it was my first love. And I still love Janet. I always will. She has a special place in my heart.
Whilst Janet was breaking hearts on the small screen, brother Michael had established his groundbreaking collaboration with renowned producer Quincy Jones and parted ways with his father as his manager.
It was clear that he was losing Michael, but he did have Janet. So that was the one that he concentrated on.
A reluctant 16-year-old Janet was soon recording her first album under the watchful eye of her father.
Your body chemistry, your history is mine. I like it, I like your style.
With no direct artistic input in the writing or production, Janet looked to be going through the motions.
We can sell the Jackson name to sell records, but, you know, who really knows if she's really talented? You know, what does she really have to say?
In contrast to Brother Michael's solo albums, the Janet Jackson album made little impact. Big-name disco producer Giorgio Moroder, who had scored hits for Donna Summer, was called in to produce Janet's second album, 1984's Dream Street.
Feel like anything significant was happening in her early music. You know, she was one of the Jacksons, she was an actress, here's a record. And I don't think that anybody would have anticipated a particularly important career for the girl who was singing those records.
In an attempt to raise her profile, dad and manager Joe pushed Janet into taking the role of Cleo Hewitt in the hit TV series Fame.
That particular role made the least impression to me, and I'm not sure why. She doesn't resonate with me in the same way that other cast members did.
Baby, look at me and tell me what you see.
She was adorable and she was very talented as an actress, but when she came on Fame, she was very pulled back and shy, and I was surprised because it was different than how I had met her as a child. But I understood it because she was part of the Jackson clan. And so it meant that fame was upon her already, whether she wanted it or not.
Her father had plans for his daughter, but Janet had other ideas. In a fit of teen rebellion, she eloped with pop heartthrob James DeBarge, who delivered a series of hits for Motown in the mid-80s.
I knew James DeBarge very well. I traveled with his family when I was at Motown during the All This Love album in February of 83. And in every city, Janet was calling James. They were very much in love.
We know now that she had a very domineering and dictatorial father in Joe Jackson, but that marriage she saw as the way out, as emancipation.
Unfortunately, the reality of marriage didn't turn out as 18-year-old Janet hoped.
She had obviously impulsively and quickly gone off and eloped and found herself in a hairy situation with a husband who was struggling with drugs. She would have to get called out to pick him up or find him. What she found herself in with the marriage to James DeBarge was something very different than she'd signed up for.
In an attempt to sort out her life, Janet left the cast of Fame, quit acting, and the marriage was annulled after little more than a year.
I think that's the reason that we see the kind of very strong, willful, self-possessed decisions that we see from her later. Like, she really has this process of defining herself, not just as an artist, but as a woman in her own space.
While Janet was struggling to find her way, her brother Michael's seemingly unstoppable rise had hit an obstacle. The launch of the 24-hour music television channel MTV in 1981 had revolutionized the record industry. Round-the-clock exposure of a song's promotional video was now key to any record success. But MTV was primarily a white rock music channel, and it was uncertain whether they would show the Billie Jean video from Michael's 1982 album, Thriller.
Well, after the video of Billie Jean was made, we gave it to our promotion department. They came back, with saying that MTV refused to play it, that they weren't playing any videos by any black artists.
There was nothing racist about MTV. Their logic was that the largest format were white rock acts, because on radio, white rock acts and black rock acts did not mix really well, according to the audiences who listen to those formats.
That's crazy to me that they wouldn't even play a Billie Jean, or, considering how much the music has influenced white music, or pop music. It's really?
MTV is a product of the very apartheid that we're starting to see on the radio airwaves in the 1980s. I don't think they even thought twice about programming black acts, right? This was about white kids.
Thank God for Walter Yetnikoff, the chairman of Columbia, who said to MTV in no uncertain terms, if you don't play Michael Jackson's videos, you're not going to have any of our videos. We're pulling them off.
The screening of Michael's landmark video for Thriller earned MTV the highest viewing figures in the channel's history.
MTV realized that their audience was much bigger if they were inclusive of a wide variety of kinds of music than all the other acts, Lionel Richie, Prince, Janet Jackson, that represented the wide spectrum, not of rock music, but of pop music, became MTV's staple.
What have you done for me lately? In 1986, Janet took full advantage of this opportunity to showcase the lead single from her new album. Not only was the music a huge leap forward from her previous work, she was now writing her own lyrics, which, like the work of her contemporary, Madonna, reflected the changing attitudes of female audiences in the 80s.
What have you done for me lately? That's crazy, I loved it. I just remember the shoulders like that. What have you done for me lately? Demanding something from her guy. And still being cute and sweet, but with that look in her eye that was like, not having it, you know?
Like, back up, honey. Back up.
You seem to think you're God's gift to the sun.
Back up and back off. And she was just like, enough. I'm going to be who I am, and I'm going to speak loudly for myself, which was at the same time speaking loudly for women. So she really became an icon of that whole kind of feminist movement.
With her album Control, Janet came of age. And in an era when women were fighting for equality, Janet was fighting for her own independence.
This is a story about control, my control. control of what I say and control of what I do.
She distanced herself from her father, moving to Minneapolis to work with the relatively unknown but cutting-edge Prince protégés, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. Together they started working on a completely new sound for Janet.
I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. It's all about control.
The first two albums didn't really work. It was just a bunch of different producers, and everybody was writing songs and basically putting words in her mouth. You didn't have the emotional investment in the project.
Are we ready? I am. Because it's all about control.
She did take control. It wasn't just the gimmick for the album. It wasn't just a song title. That's what she was going through.
Control was her destiny. I mean, it was the most fitting title for her life at that time. She was under the control of her father. She had issues with her marriage. So it was a lot of drama, and she was depending on other people. She was in her mid-teens, taking direction from your father. So her father had primary creative control.
Craving that control herself, 19-year-old Janet sacked her father, Joseph.
She made a business decision.
I felt it was a good move at the time. Sometimes my dad can't understand it.
I had gone through so much at that age when I began working with Jimmy and Terry. I felt that I can't be the only young adult in this world that is experiencing these feelings, having these issues. So I put them down. I was writing what was going on in my life, which is, that's the way I've always written. That's the only way I know how to write.
These were her moments of absolute self-definition. And not only was she defining who she was as a woman, she also was deciding that she was not only going to be a recording artist, but she was going to be a star.
The album redefined Janet. Not only was it a hit on the black R&B chart, it produced 5 top 10 hits on America's mainstream Billboard chart, including her first number one, When I Think of You.
The record had hit song after hit song after hit song after hit song. It transcended black and white. It became universal.
As well as making Janet a star, the album's innovative production, the result of her collaboration with Jam and Lewis, would have a huge impact on the future sound of black music.
You watch how she sings, her vocal almost becomes part of the instrumentation because of the way she attacks the words.
You nasty boys, nasty, nasty boys, I don't ever change.
She's singing nasty, it can't be nasty, it's gotta be nasty!
Nasty!
As a producer, it made it so great because a lot of times if you had a funky track and you put a singer with it and the singer couldn't kind of keep up with the funk and the attitude of the track, it would be like, eh, didn't work. She would help propel the track along because of her little, she would always kind of do that as she was singing and it would become, you know, another funky element.
Who's Jimmy?
Embraced by producer Teddy Riley, this slick new sound would form the basis of a whole new genre, New Jack Swing, a fusion of R&B, rap, funk, disco, and synthesized percussion.
Teddy Riley is much more conscious of bringing in hip-hop elements into his mix, right? But he's doing so firmly aware of the kind of success that Jam and Lewis had.
No, my first name ain't Baby, it's Janet. Miss Jackson, if you're nasty. Nasty boys, but don't do anything. Oh, you nasty boys.
Nasty was probably the first kind of swing beat song that was popular. And I think the effect that the album had was it got people thinking outside the box a little bit as to what R&B is.
The release of Control in 1986 not only created a blueprint for the future direction of R&B, it firmly established Janet as an independent and assertive artist in her own right.
Control could have been a fluke. It was so personal that maybe that was all she had in her. You know, maybe that was the big statement, and then it was sort of going to be copying that the rest of the way.
For her next album, record company A&M wanted Janet to deliver more love songs, but Janet had other priorities.
I was more interested in what was going on in our world. I started seeing all these stories and drugs, racism, homelessness. It really concerned me.
In the 80s, America's inner cities had been hit hard by a combination of recession and severe budget cuts.
We're in control here. There's nothing wrong with America that together we can't fix.
Industry is reeling from the recession. In affluent America, the soup kitchen has been revived by public authorities.
You couldn't turn on CNN without being blown away by the tragedy in the news. Something started, you know, burning creatively with us as to what the album should be. And the blueprint, not really the blueprint for the album, but the inspiration for the album then became Marvin Gaye's What's Going On Out.
Soul singer Marvin Gaye's album What's Going On had taken a critical look at racism and inequality in late 60s America. Janet now looked to the urban black community of the 80s and the emerging hip-hop scene for her lyrical and musical inspiration.
What Janet was doing, I think, was picking up on what was happening during that time. There was a lot of changes. People were starting to get comfortable with having a voice. And the voice was coming through at that time through music and dance. It was like the modern day blues for African American, for ethnic people in general.
The thing about Janet is she would go out and just hang in regular places. She would come to the teen nightclubs. I mean, she hung out and she loved it. And she would talk about things that would really hurt her. You know, poverty and racism, you know, those things that really, really struck at the core of her. And I think Rhythm Nation was really important, a really important vehicle for her to share that side of it.
On the Rhythm Nation 1814 album, Janet, Jimmy, and Terry would adopt hip-hop production techniques and sample classic old-school songs. For the album's title track, they used a sample of a Sly and the Family Stone funk anthem.
And all of a sudden, it went to the break of the song. And the break of the song is this guitar riff. And I just said, that's it. That's it. I knew that was the riff. And I went straight to the studio, looped that guitar riff, and then started building it from there. Put in the drums, put in the keyboards, and all that stuff over.
they weren't imitating hip hop, but they were certainly taking a different kind of energy and a different kind of, you know, more aggressive rhythm.
Woo, that's fun.
They painted in broader strokes. They used bigger sounds and more sounds. They used that amazing Sly Stone sample that's what drives the Rhythm Nation song. Technology was changing. All of these things were happening, and she wasn't chasing those trends. She wasn't following. She was very much a leader at that time.
MTV, the channel that had once refused to put black artists on their playlist, now embraced Janet, not only as a recording artist, but also as a producer of innovative videos. Keen to give emerging street dance talent a platform, Janet enlisted unknown 21-year-old locker and popper Anthony Thomas to devise the choreography.
The craziest thing about it was she had never really told me that I was the lead choreographer, that I was the guy. They kept giving me stuff to do. And I'm like, man, am I really like the choreographer for this? I'd never stirred up a gumbo like that before, you know? It was either locking over here or popping over here. No one had ever gone, ooh, that's kind of cool. You know, no one had ever mixed it up like that.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. You know, that strength from the word go, you had to see that this Janet Jackson funk army was here to stay. We weren't playing around.
In 1990, the Rhythm Nation video won a Grammy and the MTV Vanguard Award for its groundbreaking choreography. Rhythm Nation was a huge commercial success, but a young Janet hoped the song could also serve a real purpose.
I know that our album or song can't change the world, but for those who are on the borderline, hopefully it will make a difference in that person's life by listening to what we have to say. Let's work together to improve our way of life. Join voices in protest, to social injustice. A generation full of maybe I could create something that was thought-provoking for someone that was on drugs and made them realize. Listen to the music, then understand, okay, wait, there's a message in this. Just hopefully to help one person, that would be an accomplishment.
Actor Michael K. Williams, who plays Omar in cult TV series The Wire, was one of the very people Janet was trying to reach.
Lost in my low self-esteem. I was low in my lack of awareness. I was low in drug addiction. You know, I was lost in a lot of different ways. And when I saw Rhythm Nation, I was like, I felt like she was talking to me. I'm just so grateful that I know that she touched me through her music. Rhythm Nation definitely changed my life on a personal level and a professional level. We are a part of a Rhythm Nation, you know. That blew my mind.
The Rhythm Nation album proved even more popular than its predecessor, Control. With 7 top 5 singles, including 4 number ones on the Billboard chart, Janet smashed the record previously held by Big Brother Michael with his album Thriller.
Michael was very close to his little sister. The language did change when she started getting hits. When she did Control, it was like, okay, this is cute. Let's see what happens here. First number one record, oh my God, my sister's got a number one record. That third number one, yeah, Janet's got another number one record. that fourth number one, okay, the gloves are off. You're competition now.
In just 5 years, Janet had sold 14 million albums in the U.S. alone and scored 15 hit singles.
She is a star. She is, not only does she have the talent to make important records, she now has an aesthetic that now is not only competing with her brother, but she's also now giving Madonna some pause.
Now one of the most successful women in pop, and with her record contract with A&M coming to an end, Janet was free to pick and choose from the major record labels.
Everybody and their mother was trying to get Janet. I mean, everyone from CBS to Motown tried to get into the fight, Warner Brothers. I mean, everyone was after this woman because she was the hottest thing. She had something over all the other artists that she competed with, and that is her brother was Michael. She had the opportunity to learn at the loafers of this guy.
I think the economic deals that Janet Jackson does in the 1990s was the record industry responding to the fact that things had changed, that you could, in fact, you know, carry the success of the industry on the crossover success of an African-American artist.
Richard Branson literally opened up the bank and just said, listen, whatever we can do to make this deal happen, let's do it.
In 1991, Branson signed Janet to his Virgin record label for $40 million. At the time, it was the biggest deal in music industry history.
Did it shock me? No, this was my 9-to-5, it was my work, and I got this, I mean, I hate to make it sound like this, but it was like, okay, you get a promotion, but what a huge promotion it was, but I'm doing my job and I try to do it to the best of my ability and give my all when I do it, and I work very, very hard, still to this day, so it was my job, my life, you know?
With that record deal under her belt, Janet was now firmly established and able to wield considerable creative and commercial control over her career. In the same year that she signed to Virgin, she also secretly married long-term friend, former dancer and video director, Renee Elizondo. Her newfound personal and creative confidence was reflected on her next album. Simply titled Janet, her first album for Virgin delivered the love songs that her former record company had craved.
Come with me, don't you worry.
The album's debut single, That's the Way Love Goes, went straight to number one on the US Billboard charts and stayed there for 8 weeks.
If Rhythm Nation was sort of our version of What's Going On, then Janet was our version of Let's Get It On.
The title is so incredibly telling that it's simply Janet. It's not Janet Jackson. It's simply Janet there, and I think that her sensuality, more than her sexuality, is completely intact. I think she's very happy with her body, and she feels like she's earned the right on a different level to express herself.
I don't wanna stop just because you feel so good inside of my love. I'm not gonna stop, no, no, no.
And then with each subsequent record, you know, she gets more and more provocative to the point where you're like, Janet, like, you know, man.
And any place I don't get hold around. No, 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 no.
It wasn't only the lyrics that were becoming more provocative. Janet arranged a photo shoot with leading fashion photographer Patrick Demarchelier to create a unique cover for her new album.
For me, it's just a good cover, a very, very special good cover, you know. Now, but if you think the hands is like a bra, you know, you have instead of a bra, you have two hands, you know. People know, want to know who the hand is, but I don't tell anybody. Everybody want to know who's this hand.
Starting to burn with a bit of thought.
The hands belonged to husband Renee, but the risque picture proved too much for her record label.
That was actually supposed to be the album cover. They didn't want to use it for the album cover. So I said, okay, which I thought, coming up with the idea, I thought it would make a great album cover. So I said, okay, that's fine, don't use it for the album cover. I said, let's use it for a magazine cover instead. So that's when we went to Rolling Stone, and they fell in love with it.
She has this banging body, and she's, you know, she's ready to show it.
With the Rolling Stone cover that, you know, became one of the most iconic images of a pop star ever.
I had a lot of friends talking about, oh man, what could I do to meet her? Where is she at? Who is she? Man, come on, man, I didn't know she looked like that. I didn't know she looked like that from Good Times. You know, you start hearing all different stuff, and I'm like, look, man, this is my aunt. I've come too
close to happiness. Janet worked closely with her new husband, Renee, forming a formidable creative partnership. And there's no doubt her album, Janet, reflected a woman at ease both in her life and her work.
I love the Again video. It was a very, very intimate part of Janet that she was letting people see. And I think that, you know, that video was directed by Renee, and they were together at the time, and knew how to find her vulnerability, knew how to comfort her in allowing that to come out, and how to shoot it.
She had moved to a different place in her career and in her life, and this album was about a different relationship to herself. The fact that she could be successful showing this most feminine side of herself just demonstrated the range of what was possible for her. Say it just one time. Say you love me.
God knows I do love you again. Michael Jackson records, they aren't really personal records. And I think with Janet, her records were deeply personal in ways that Michael's weren't. With the exception of Leave Me Alone and a few other things, he didn't really talk about himself. Whereas Janet's records were basically open books. Whilst Janet was now firmly established as one of the biggest pop stars of the 90s, brother Michael's career was in crisis.
Michael needed Janet much more at the moment that he does Scream than Janet ever needed Michael.
After a year battling allegations of child sexual abuse, Michael was acquitted of all charges in 1994. But now, 5 years since his last album, Dangerous, Michael was struggling to re-establish his place as the king of pop. Michael turned to his little sister, Janet, to co-write his comeback single, Scream. Janet encouraged Michael to adopt a more direct and personal approach to his lyrics. Together, they vented their anger at the tabloid press who had hounded Michael long before his trial.
Michael and Janet are very, very different artists. And I think that when you watch Scream, you'll see that, yes, they were angry. They had a reason to be angry. A lot of the dance came out very forceful and very strong. Being in the shadow. It spoke volumes when you watch their movement. Tell me I'm wrong, then you better prove your pride.
Selling our souls, cause I care about mine. This is what black power looks like. You know, it could take the form of an Oprah Winfrey. You know, it could take a form of Will Smith. It could also take the form in a brother and sister who are highly competitive, right? But by being competitive, right, they've been able to push their artistic sensibilities further than anyone would have ever expected.
I remember going into the studio and Michael just blew it away, first take, just killed it with all the anger and the rage. house. Like, I'm not following that. Nobody's following Michael Jackson after that.
Feeling the pressure, Janet opted to record in a different studio on a different day and laid down a vocal that more than matched her brother's performance.
Michael goes, I want to come to Minneapolis and redo my vocal. It's like, Michael, your vocal's perfect, man. He's like, no, I got to redo. Janet sounds really good. I have to redo my vocal. And it's like, okay, fine. So that's competition. I don't know if it's healthy competition.
I think she's absolutely been competitive with her brother, but in the way that women should be competitive. I think that Janet is the prototype of the girl who's raised to be a nice girl and could have had a reasonably successful career as a nice girl. But when she was allowed to be a woman and embrace the side of her that is competitive, and competitive didn't mean that she wanted to stab her brother in the back or that she didn't love her brothers or she wasn't very much a Jackson. It meant that I want to be the best that I can be.
The competition certainly paid off. Michael and Janet's Scream, still one of the most expensive videos of all time, won both a Grammy and the MTV Award for Best Dance Video.
Janet was a major, major player in pop music history. Not only was she now just a recording artist, she was someone that the music industry at large knew they were going to have to respect.
In 1996, Janet negotiated a second record-breaking contract with Virgin, worth $80 million, and appeared to have the world at her feet. So the mood of the songs on her next album, Velvet Rope, surprised many of her fans.
If you ever want to know anything about Janet, just listen to her albums. It's all there on the album. You don't have to go buy a book or read an article or whatever. It's all right there on the records. Listen to the lyrics.
There are murmurs about her marriage with Renee Elizondo, about the fact, is it still going on? Are they still married? There's all this speculation that if it's still happening, that it may be on the rocks.
All alone with my fears, I'm wondering if I have to do without you. There's no reason why I feel asleep.
You look around and you have everything and you're still not happy. And that's a weird feeling. And it's one that, you know, a lot of people you probably would feel wouldn't relate to it because you'd feel like, well, what's her problem? She's got everything.
The Velvet Rope album was a masterpiece. Janet was going through a lot at that time. There was a struggle, an inner struggle going on with her. Some people might want to say that it was dark, and I just think it was Janet evolving into another Janet, another place in her life.
Thank God I made the decision to deal with it as opposed to run away from it or dive into drugs or drinking, and that's where Velvet Rope came from.
Returning to hip-hop for inspiration, Janet enlisted the talents of rapper Q-Tip. Using a sample of Joni Mitchell's 1970 hit, Big Yellow Taxi, the single Got Till It's Gone helped define Janet once again as a cutting-edge artist. The process of self-examination whilst writing Velvet Rope also saw Janet return to more socially conscious lyrics.
She was looking for a way to make a contribution, to be more than just a pop icon.
friends had passed away from AIDS, and I wanted to write a song that would celebrate them, and not something that was somber, but something that was up and celebratory, and that reminded me of how their personalities, their energy, and Together Again came out of me.
There are times when I look above and beyond. There are times when I feel your love around me. I'll never forget
nothing. There were a few people that thought I should not do it, that I thought I should go in and at least redo the lyrics. They didn't want it to be about my friends passing away from AIDS. And I disagreed with that and just went with it. Some people at the label. And I'm glad I didn't back down from what I was feeling.
Together Again went on to be Janet's biggest international hit, proceeds going to AMFAR, the Foundation for AIDS Research.
When an artist puts their reputation and their career on the line in the way that Janet does, for causes which may not be popular with everyone, Janet does that in a tradition, I think, of people willing to put their name on the line for a cause that they care deeply about. But I think it was also reflective of someone who was searching for a bigger voice, and I think she found it.
Key to Janet's continued global appeal was her ability to connect with audiences everywhere, regardless of age, sexuality, or race.
So it's African Americans, it's Latino, it's Filipino Americans. I mean, you know, if you wanted the best face of what America looked like, just look at a Janet Jackson video, right? And they're all beautiful and pretty, right? You know, it's like a Benetton ad.
As the new millennium rolled in, Janet was single again. Now divorced from second husband Renee, the album All For You celebrated her newfound freedom. The title track went to number one in the US charts, stayed there for 7 weeks, and made radio airplay history. Despite the album being knocked from the top of the charts by young upstarts Destiny's Child, the Queen of Radio wasn't ready to give up her throne. At the top of the pop game for over 17 years, Janet, America's sweetheart, was invited to sing with Justin Timberlake at the 2004 Super Bowl final to a worldwide television audience of 145 million.
Justin Timberlake made the most of his opportunity as he tried his best to rock Janet's body. But the Prince of Pop got a little too enthusiastic. Janet was left blushing.
Janet's breast was exposed for less than a second, leading to a media frenzy.
Public concern. We've received 200,000 complaints on the Super Bowl incident.
We have a striptease in front of billions of people.
And unfortunately, the whole thing went wrong in the end.
Janet apologized, but some critics insisted it was simply a publicity stunt.
It's been taken apart and reanalyzed frame by frame. It, you know, it's like the Kennedy assassination. I think it sort of spiraled her into a place that she's, you know, clearly her career has never fully come back from.
Released just a couple of months after the Super Bowl, her next album, 2004's Demeter Joe, suggested an artist already off her game.
Remember the first day she said to Terry, "You know what, Terry, you write the lyrics." And Terry looked at her like, "What? No, Terry, you can write the lyrics. I don't really feel like I have anything to talk about." Well, you know what? Then we shouldn't be making an album if you really don't feel that way.
With over 30 hit singles since the 1986 album Control, Janet, Jimmy, and Terry had forged one of the most successful production teams of all time.
I have to say that those albums were all Control, Rhythm Nation, Janet, Velvet Rope, and All For You. Those five albums to me are really a great cohesive journey in time and journey of the evolution of a girl to a woman.
The Demeter Joe album received mixed reviews and failed to make an impact in the charts. Janet's musical evolution that began almost 20 years earlier when she took control of her life and sacked her father seemed to have come to an end. In her personal life, Janet had settled into a long-term relationship with producer Jermaine Dupri and attempted to shun the limelight. But to no avail. Since her years as a teen pop star, Janet's fluctuating weight had remained a source of tabloid fascination.
There were pictures like that were coming out on the internet. You know, does she have that body? Does she not have that body?
I was always so self-conscious of, you know, this body image. And that can swing you in the wrong direction. Either you can overeat because of it, nerves, or undereat and become anorexic.
Janet's issues with her physical appearance had first started as a child actress in Good Times.
They bound my chest. When I was on the show, they never told me they were going to do it. When I got dressed for the first episode, that's when the wardrobe lady told me that she was going to. And I was developing at a very young age. I was just 10. So that was telling me immediately that I'm not good enough as I was. And then and the following season, they said, okay, she's getting too fat. She needs to lose weight. And when I look back, I wasn't a heavy kid, but there have been times when I've been too thin, and I know that. And I've had to have my friends say to me, and I would say to them, tell me when to stop, because I don't know. I will find fault.
Patricia, wait a minute.
In 2009, Janet returned to the big screen when she was cast in Tyler Perry's Why Did I Get Married 2. As an actress, she cast vanity aside. Her critically acclaimed portrayal of curvy lawyer Patricia was both convincing and compelling.
Get out of my house. Get out of my house!
I'm interested in the director that's going to push her out of that particular angry, pained, and closed role. I'm interested in the director that can do for her what Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis did for her musically.
It was while she was on the set of Why Did I Get Married 2 that Janet received some shocking news.
It's like the world stopped. Everybody stopped. The world stopped.
There was no indication of any external trauma.
The big question is whether or not the doctor who was by his side apparently
not found since before it was confirmed that Michael Jackson died.
It was Janet who found the strength to speak to the world on behalf of the Jackson family.
To you, Michael is an icon. To us, Michael is family. And he will forever live in all of our hearts.
She's a very private person, right? But in some ways allowed her fans and Michael's fans, right, into her private space in order for her to grieve so that everyone else could grieve at the same time.
When my uncle passed, Janet did help bring everybody together. She was right there. It's actually hard to see my uncles and my aunts go through this because they are such different individuals. It didn't pull them apart. It pulled them closer. She really helped us. She keeps us together.
To have two had endured such a difficult loss, I think it either hardened some people or it just kind of adds another, I'm gonna live my life on my own terms. sense of resolve for others. And Janet definitely falls into that latter category.
Summer 2011, 25 years since her first hit single, Janet is back, staging her biggest world tour to date.
Janet Jackson will be remembered as an artist that was pushing the envelope and that empowered herself by being this young girl that was able to say, hey, this is who I am, take me and leave me.
We have so few examples of pop stars, whether or not we're talking about black pop stars or anybody, who can continue to build a career, now 30 years in the running, and be able to do it consistently on their own terms.
The music business is not what it used to be. The real players are going to be the ones who have to get out there on stage and show what they can do.
That's really what her legacy is, really more being a performer. Whether it's Britney, whether it's Rihanna, everybody that kind of wants to do a little bit of the acting, have a coquettish sexual stage presence, and then make records that talk about issues of control and issues of trying to be an icon and a woman and a sexual being at the same time. Janet was the first to really do all that.
Hey, what have you done for me lately?
People underestimate what she's contributed as a Jackson, and she's contributed a lot.
She's brilliant. I really honestly look up to her.
She's got a long, long legacy, and a lot of women will never touch her.
Ooh, yeah.
I just feel there's so much more I have to do. I remember when I was with Jermaine Dupri, I remember coming to London, and I remember calling him, and I said, Jermaine, they introduced me on the show today as legendary. And he said, well, you are. I don't see myself like that. There's so much more that I want to do, to accomplish, and that I don't think I can hold that title. Hopefully in the future I'll be able to.
No longer signed to a major record label, Janet is a free agent. And although it's been some years since she's enjoyed significant chart success, there's no doubting her legacy, and no doubting who's in control.
She has like probably at least $150 million. She's completely independent. She's making movies. I think if she makes records, she'll make them on her own terms.
I think being free is the best thing that could possibly happen to her in her life right now. She's doing the right thing by making the movies, by touring, and really embracing and enjoying the incredible legacy of music that she has.
I am free, and I have the freedom of doing whatever it is that I want to do, which is, it feels absolutely wonderful. And I love that. I'm not tied to any contract or anyone. I absolutely love it.